Hello everyone, my name is Greg and I dev stuff. Welcome everyone to episode 18 of JRPG tutorial. In this episode we are going to finalize implementation of status panel. As always, clean your root folder. So let's jump straight into action. I decided to rename our HP and MP into MP max and HP max, and add two more instances of HP char and MP current. Then add the HP current and MP current into the current stats base. Good, now for our status panel, we want to add a character portrait reference. But we have actor class for our dialogue system, where we already have reference to the portrait and the name of the character. So let's create and embed the actor into the character when we are creating the character. If you want to have an icon for each enemy, then you might want to add the actor in the create entity method, so both enemy and character will have the actor. But that is up to you and how you design your game. Okay, good, but we already have our Unity Chan and Dark Unity Chan implemented. This will be a burden if we will have to recreate the characters just to add the actors, or anytime you change the structure of your data in the characters. So we have to implement some kind of check for the integrity of our entities. So let's create a new enum called entity type. This is just for internal editor use. We will make sure that our designer will not be able to change it. Good, now when you create a character or an enemy, assign the value to the type accordingly. but because it was implemented after the creation of Aorus characters, set it to character entity type for Aorus unity chance. At the same time, we want to make sure that Aorus designer can see it, and it will be useful for debugging. So what we want is a read-only field in the inspector. Let's create a new script and let's call it read-only attribute. Inherit from property attribute. Good, now we will be able to mark any property with this attribute. Okay, now we need a property drawer for this read-only attribute. So define a new class called read-only-drawer and inherit it from property drawer. Mark this class as a custom property drawer for our read-only attribute. Good, if you check the property drawer, you can see that we can override the onGUI. Let's do that, and inside onGUI, simply call GUI enabled false for the property field, where we will pass all the parameters, and then re-enable the GUI. This is an old principle of GUI. The moment you mark as disabled, it will make everything what is called and placed after that disabled. And it will be making a disabled GUI elements right until you re-enable the GUI. You know, looking at this, let's separate creation and embedding of the parts into separate method, so we will avoid repeating ourselves. Pass entity, type of the class we want to embed, and the name of the file which embed file will have. And return scriptable object we created, so we can assign it to the variable or something. This way we can create a new instance of the scriptable object, embed it into our entity, and then store the reference to it into our entity after we simply return it. Don't forget to replace the value container part in the create entity. Okay, now we want to implement the integrity system check. What I mean is that if you change the entity script, you want to make sure that all of your entities has a complete package of what they're supposed to represent. For example, if we check our current Unity Chan, you will see that she lacks actor. So in onEnable, we will check the type of entity, and then based on that, we will check is ours variable null or not. In case it is null, we will create an embed stuff accordingly. So for enemy type it will be just and stats, and for character it will be stats and actor. So now if we open the editor, our Unity Chan and Dark Unity Chan should acquire the actor instance. Good, attach the Unity Chan portrait to the actor. Okay, now what we want to do is to implement the status panel. So first we will implement ability to read the party pool and show status for each character. Select the panel which is apparent to your character panel and rename it to party panel. create another new script called Party Status Panel. The script will ensure the synchronization between what your party status panel is showing and what your party pool has. Prefab the character panel and place exact amount of status panels as you will have maximum amount of characters in the combat. For us, let's do 3. You can do that process through the code. I just rarely see people changing party size mid-development, and even if they do it, it is a very quick process to add more of those panels. Good, now open the party status panel and inside create a serialized list for those character status panels and serialize reference to the party. Go back to the editor and assign the references. Let's go into execution order and place party status panel as far as possible, because as a UI element, it should be executed after everything is done doing so. Okay, so what we have to do now is to read our current party and depict it in the party status panel. By the way, I did some editing of the Dark Yunti-chan picture, so she will look more dark and edgy, you know, and assign her portrait to her entity instance. In the status party panel, create a new method called show, and inside, by checking the current count of party members, show panels and hide an access panel to be used for later. Create a new method called setPanel with parameter characterStatusPanel and combatCharacter. Inside we will set the statusPanel for our character. Call and create a new method called set and pass our combatCharacter. Inside the newly created set function, we want to pass all the necessary data from our character to be tracked on the panel. But combat character doesn't have all of those data stored, because it is stored on the character instead. Because combat character is only responsible for the combat side of the character functionality. So, I think it is safe to assume with our implementation that if you have a combat character, then you will have a character attached to this object at the same time. Because even for enemies, we will be reusing the character script. So, on the start, let's save the public reference to the character in the combat character. We want to define a serialized reference to all elements of the status panel. It will be a character icon. And three status bars, one for HP, one for SP, and one for ATB. And create three pairs of serialized references for the values you will be tracking. We will use it so we will be able to set up the status bars. I know this doesn't look too well, but I honestly don't see a reason to try to use any modular system except just to remove this long list of references in our case. And at this point I don't think it is a good way to spend our time. If you want, you can try to do it yourself as a homework experiment. Like, try to make a fully dynamic character status panel. And if you want, you can let me know in the comments that you want to see a fully dynamic status panel for the characters. So back to the set method, and inside let's pass the character sprite from the character. We will make entity public in the character script, and I made a mistake with the type. Open the actor script and change the type of the character portrait from texture 2D to sprite. My bad, I'm sorry. So let's redo our set in the bar a little. What we want to do is just simply have two value references. One will represent the maximum state and one will represent the current state. Good. Now inside the update bar we want to calculate the fill of the bar and assign it based on values of this value reference. Problem is, you as a programmer don't know what type of values your designer will want to use for the bar. It can be a float or an integer. So we want to calculate our field value depending on used type of values. do that, create a float variable called field amount and two pairs of references, one for value int reference and one for float reference. Method, and then we will subscribe the update bar method to on change delegate on both of those references. Then create two methods, one is calculateFloat and calculateInt. And then inside calculateInt, calculate the field amount based on the integer values, and in the calculateFloat, do the same but for float values. Then make a serialized reference to the text for GUI element where we will write the current HP state. Then create an action called calculate. In the set, determine the type of value reference and based on that assign the proper method of calculation to ours calculate delegate. In the editor, open the prefab of the character status panel and reference the text inside the bar. Then set all the value reference and all reference to the bars on the panel. Future Greg here. I made a mistake and forget to do that over here. I will do that on the debugging process. Let's go back to the party status panel and inside OnStart call set panel for each character in the party. I did the testing before and I know that we will have to fix some issues. First, let's go into party script and change the start to awake to prioritize the party initialization before it interacts with anything. Then let's assign some states into current and max HP values on the unity chan and dark unity chan. Let's fix all the mistakes I made in the course of the arduous recording session. There was many, I'm sorry, I'm too tired. So now if we've launched the game, it should assign the values to the bar. Well, something is wrong with our spill amount. You remember the formula on max HP. That is why. If you remove the formula, it will be taking default variable. For the testing purposes, remove the formula for now. So we are left with ATB bar, and we will have to change the implementation of ATB a little to fit what we have right now. Open action timer, and if you remember what I said is that our section timer exists outside the persistent data on the character. This creates a certain complication in the system. If you just place those two values, I'm speaking of current AT and the target AT, on the character, this will simplify implementation immensely. But similar to my explanation before, this data does not need to stay persistent and does not need to be stored on the character. Because if you keep adding every value on your character just for convenience sake, you end up with buff timers in your character values or something, and we don't want that. So the change we have to do is to store target AT into a value reference rather than just serialized field. So declare serialized reference to the value called target AT value, then create a value reference to the target AT. Remove my bar variable, we don't use this part anymore. Change check AT to use a newly created target AT reference. Then go back to initialization of the status panel and pass the values from the action timer. Now because we did that, we can remove the AT bar from init in our combat character. Actually, we can move action timer init to start too, because even if we init the combat character, it will not work until something will start sending tick value to it. If we test, there is a small issue. The timer will not stop ticking and there is a null ref for the enemies. This is fine, we will fix it in the next episode, where we are going to start working on actual combat execution. This will be it for this episode. If you have any questions or any ideas about code, please leave your comments below. If you are interested in seeing what will come out of this, please subscribe. If you want to support further, you can find my Patreon in the description. With best regards, see you in the next episode.